Hi friends, in our last session we have seen mechanical drive. Now in this session we are going to see hydraulic transmission and its elements. This is Faizan Kavvi and I welcome you all to our lecture series of machine tool design. So let's begin. Hydraulic transmission and its elements. So it mainly consists of the following five elements. First element name is a pump. Second one is a hydraulic cylinder. Third one is direction control valve. Fourth one is a pressure valve. Fifth one is a throttle valve. So let's begin with the first type, that is pumps. Now as the name itself suggests, what is pump? So we would say pump is a power absorbing device. It is used to convey liquid from one place to another place. Right. It is going to extract liquid from a one place and then discharge or deliver to the another place. Okay, similarly we can say that it is also able to lift water from an underground surface and deliver it to a tanks. Now in our case of a machine tools, we would say it has a purpose of sucking the oil from our reservoir and delivering it under pressure into a hydraulic device. Now this hydraulic device will be our hydraulic cylinder. Remember that. Okay, so what a pump does, so we would say it is going to impart pressure energy. Okay, now how the pressure is obtained, so we would say by supplying a mechanical power, that is our rotary motion from our electric motor, it is supplied to a pump and finally pump is going to increase the pressure of the oil. Now pump are basically of two types, constant delivery pump and variable delivery pumps. The constant delivery pumps are generally employed in a machine tools and there are mainly two types, that is gear pump and second type is called a vane pump. So let us understand it. Now as you can see on your screen, the diagram of a gear pump is shown. So it consists of a casing and a two gears. One is a driving gear, another one will be a driven gear. Driving gear will be connected to the electric motor. Okay, now you can see the process is shown. In the first process, filling inside a gear pump takes place. Second is a transfer process and third one is a delivery process. So how the filling is going to take place? So let us consider that our driving gear is going to rotate in a clockwise. So our driven gear will rotate in an anti-clockwise direction. A liquid is going to enter from our left side of that is our suction side. Okay, high vacuum will be created and the liquid will get trapped between the two teeth and a casing. Okay, now these teeth are going to rotate in our anti-clockwise direction, right? It's going to rotate in a clockwise direction. So that oil will get trapped between two teeth and a casing and finally will be delivered to the discharge side, that is on a right side of a pump. Okay, so as you can see that in a second diagram of a gear pump, filling has been done, right? It has been trapped and finally in a third diagram you can see a discharge of a oil is going to take place. Now in this you need to keep in mind that the flow of liquid, that is oil, takes place along the periphery of a pump. This is most important thing which you need to keep in mind. It is never going to flow through the center. Why? Because there is an airtight seal between the two gears. Why? Because meshing is going to take place, so liquid cannot transfer through the center. Okay, so this is one of the type. Next is a vane pump. As you can see, the construction is very simple. There is a cylindrical rotor at the center, okay, and there are slots provided on its periphery. Okay, so this cylindrical rotor is arranged eccentrically with respect to the cylindrical casing. So you can see a pump body is shown, which is of a cylindrical shape. Now both are arranged eccentrically. So we can say that the center of both the circles, that is the circle of a cylindrical rotor and that of a cylindrical casing, are on the same vertical line but has a different center. Okay, if we say a concentric, which means that circles, center of both the circles are same, okay, but eccentrically arranged. So what is the requirement for that? So we require a gradual increment in an area and a gradual decrement in an area. So you can see in a, the space between both the cylindrical rotor and a casing, there is a increment in an area and finally there is a decrement in an area. This is done purposely. Okay, now you can see there is a vanes provided. There are four vanes corresponding to four slots. These vanes can slide inside a slot. So these vanes will always remain in contact with the inner surface of a cylindrical casing when a cylindrical rotor is going to rotate at a high speed, which means a centrifugal force will be exerted on these vanes. Okay, and that vane will remain in contact firmly with the inner surface of a cylindrical casing. Remember this thing. Okay, now let us see the working. So as you can see on the left side, there is an inlet. Liquid is going to enter, that is oil is going to enter through the inlet, and first it will get trapped between the two vanes, rotor and an outer, that is a stationary casing. Now once it gets trapped, we would say that a vane is going to move, let's say, in a clockwise direction, right? So it is going to carry the liquid that is trapped between the two vanes, the rotor, that is cylindrical rotor, and outer, that is a casing. That liquid can only be moved to the particular space. Okay, now definite volume has been trapped between these power components. Okay, so what is going to happen? When our area is going to reduce at a delivery side, the volume is higher, but area is going to reduce. So what is going to happen? So we would say a compression on a liquid will take place, which is going to increase the pressure of a liquid. So on a delivery side, there is an outlet side, high pressure liquid can be achieved by means of this vane pump. Now we need to keep in mind that a quantity, that is a amount of liquid which is going to trap, is going to remain fixed, and because of that it is called a constant delivery pump. Okay, so we have seen there are two types of constant delivery pump, that is a gear pump and vane pump, which are used in our machine tools. Now let us move further and see our next component of our hydraulic drive, that is hydraulic cylinder. Now as you can see, now what is the function of hydraulic cylinder? So hydraulic cylinder is going to take the pressurized liquid from a pump. Okay, so what is the function? So we would say that pressurized liquid will be used to convert into a translatory motion. Remember, translatory motion means a linear motion. So the function of hydraulic cylinder is to produce linear motion, which means what a hydraulic cylinder is going to operate. So it is going to operate the bed, machine tool bed. We know that a bed has to perform whichever motion, a linear motion, in case of a planing machine, in case of a shaping machine, in case of a milling machine, right? So you need to keep this in mind. Using a hydraulic drive, a translatory motion of an operative member is required. Okay, a simple cylinder with a piston rod only on one side, which is shown in figure A, you can see, provides a different piston velocity in two directions. Why? Because there is piston rod only on one side of a cylinder. Whereas if we use a double end rod cylinder, then it provides an identical piston velocity in both the directions, which is shown in your figure B. Okay, now if we need to determine a discharge, that how much quantity of liquid has been discharged, so we know from a continuity equation which you have studied in your fluid mechanics, that is Q is equal to A into V, where Q is a discharge, A is the area of a cylinder, and V is the velocity of a fluid which has to be discharged. So Q, you can see, that is Q will be in meter cube per minute, area, effective area of a cross section of a piston, or we can say of a cylinder, that would be in meter square, and velocity of a piston, that would be in meter per minute. Okay, so over here you need to keep in mind that two types of hydraulic cylinder, that is with the only one side piston rod only on one side, and second piston rod on both the sides of a piston. Now we will see how this is going to operate. Now let's see the next part of this hydraulic device, that is we need to see direction control valves. Now as the name itself suggests, that direction control valve is going to control the direction, which means it is going to change the direction of a fluid to flow. Okay, so there are many two types. The first type is called a rotary spool, and the second type is called a sliding piston. So now let us understand the rotary spool type direction control valve. So as you can see in a construction, on the bottom side there is a reservoir shown in which oil will be filled. There is a pump shown. Okay, so what a pump is going to do, it's going to suck the liquid from a reservoir and increase its pressure and discharge into a hydraulic cylinder through the direction control valve. Okay, now the circular portion you can see is a valve shown. It has four ports, port 1, 3, 2 and 4. Now port 1 of a valve is connected to the left side of a cylinder, port 2 of the valve is connected to the right side of a cylinder. Okay, and port 3 of a valve is connected with a pump, which means the liquid from a pump with a high pressure is going to enter into a valve through port number 3, remember. Okay, now let us see how it's going to operate. So as you can see that a valve is shown with a two vertical form lines. Okay, that is the two vertical lines are shown.
So let's say that a spool is at that particular position, that is vertical position. So visualize that what is going to happen. So when a liquid is going to enter from a pump into a valve through port 3, that liquid will flow into a cylinder through which port? So we would say through port number 1. On which side of a cylinder? So on a left side of a cylinder. Okay, which means it is going to push a piston towards the right side. That liquid will push a piston towards the right side. Now what is going to happen? So whatever liquid which is present on the right side of a piston will be pressurized. That liquid will flow back into a valve and enter through port number 2. See port number 2, right? Now from port number 2, that liquid will enter into a reservoir through port number 4. Okay, so when a spool is placed vertically, okay, when vertical position is achieved, then which ports are connected? So 3 is connected with the 1. Okay, liquid will enter on left side, will push the piston on the right side, whereas port number 2 will connect with port number 4, and liquid from a right side of a piston will draw back, will drain directly into a reservoir. Okay, through port number 2 and 4. Now visualize a case that we rotated a spool from vertical position to the horizontal position. So what is going to happen, which is shown by the dashed line, you can see. So in that case, port number 3 and port number 2 will get connected, right? So the liquid from a pump will enter on a right side of a cylinder, that is on a right side of a piston, will push a piston towards the left side, and whatever oil or a liquid which is present on a left side of a piston will flow back through port number 1 into a valve, okay, and from port number 1 it will be connected to port number 4. Why? Because the spool is kept horizontally. So which connections we are going to get? So from port number 1 to port number 4, and finally from port number 4 the oil will get discharged back into the reservoir. Okay, so remember, when the spool is kept horizontally, so which two ports are going to connect? So port 3 and 2 are going to connect, which will push the liquid into a right side of a cylinder. Piston will move on a left side, and whatever liquid is there on a left side of a piston will flow back into a reservoir through port number 1 and 4. Okay, and finally will discharge back into a reservoir. So this is how a rotary spool type direction control valve is going to operate. Now let us understand the piston type direction control valve. So construction is almost the same, that is a pump is used, reservoir is used, and a hydraulic cylinder is same. Now what is the main difference? So you would say that over here the valve used is a piston type, which means a piston cylinder arrangement is used. Okay, so there are two pistons and both the pistons are connected by a rod, that is a piston rod. Now in the diagram, as you can see, that two positions of a pistons are shown. First position is shown by the form line, that is the two pistons are shown by a form line, right? Okay, and second position of a piston is shown by the dashed line, so indicating the another position of a piston. Now let us see that over here there are 5 ports provided with the valve. Okay, port 1 is connected to the left side of a cylinder, port 2 is connected to the right side of a cylinder, okay, and port 3 is connected to the pump. Okay, you need to keep in mind, and port 4 and port 5 are the draining ports, which means the liquid will flow back to these two ports back into the reservoir. Now let us understand the working. So I am considering a case in which first piston is in a position shown by the form lines. Okay, so how it's gonna operate? So we would say pump is going to suck the liquid from a reservoir, that liquid will flow into the valve. So port 3 will get connected to port 1, and liquid from a pump will enter on a left side of a piston. It's going to push a piston towards the right side. Okay, and whatever liquid which is present on the right side of a piston will flow back into a valve through port 2, and port 2 will get connected to port 5. Why? Because we are considering a case in which pistons are shown by the form lines, which means port 2 and 5 will get connected, and finally liquid will drain back into a reservoir. Okay, now when a piston is going to achieve a position shown by the dashed line, you can see it is shown by the dashed line. So what's going to happen? So we would say that a liquid from point number 3 will enter into point number 2. Now just ignore the line which is shown by the form lines. So what's going to happen? So point number 3 will get connected to point number 2. Liquid will enter on a right side of a cylinder. it will push a piston towards the left side. Whatever liquid which is present on the left side will flow back into a valve through port 1. And from port 1, the liquid will flow into a port 4. And finally, through port 4, it is going to enter back into a reservoir. So this is how a piston type direction control valve is going to operate. Okay guys, so in today's session, we are keeping up till here. In next session, we will continue with our next topic, that is of a throttle valve. Okay, and pressure valves. So till then, stay tuned and thank you all.